Hey, church, welcome to GV Online. Happy Easter. We are excited to celebrate our risen Savior with you. Jesus built his church so that we may celebrate together, be encouraged together, love one another as we love Jesus. And we're going to begin with a song. So let's worship him.
your blood is healing every wound. Your blood is making all things new. Your blood speaks a better word. Your blood, measure of my worth. Your blood, more than I deserve. Your blood speaks a better word. Speaks a better word. It's singing out with life. It's shouting down the line. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word. Speaks a better word.
Yeah.
destiny.
Shall reign. Hey everybody, welcome to GV Christian Center. We are so glad that you chose to join us to celebrate Easter this week. We wanted to just take a minute to let you know about some awesome things that we offer here for you and your family. Every weekend, we offer incredible programs at every one of our services, Sundays at 9 and 11 for you and your whole family. We have kids programs ranging from infants to junior high, as well as a traditional service every Sunday at 9 a.m. In addition to the weekend services, our Next Gen department, that's our kids, youth, and young adult ministries, offers programs throughout the week. In fact, our biggest ministry night of the week is Wednesday night. Your kids are gonna wanna be here on Wednesday night. We have our youth programs across the street at our 706 building, and this building here is packed with kids every single Wednesday. While your kids are in the kids programs on Wednesday nights, you can connect with God and others as well. In fact, there are many adult life groups, one of which meets right here in our cafe every Wednesday night. Now, if Wednesday night doesn't work for you, we have adult life groups throughout the week. Our men and women, in fact, meet every Monday night for a Bible study right here on campus. So come out, check out one of the life groups, and get connected with others. Summer is coming up quick, and we've got some amazing things happening this summer, kicking it off with Kids Week. We're gonna be packing this place with kids. We have so much fun. Look out for that. Then, following quick after, is gonna be Youth Camp, Kids Camp, and in July, two missions trips. We're sending two teams, one to Germany to reach out to Ukrainian refugees, and one to Nicaragua to help underprivileged kids and work in a rural village. To find out more about any of these things, weekend services, kids, youth, young adults, missions trips, camps, all of these awesome things going on, just scan the QR code on the chair in front of you or on the screen you're watching, or go to gvchristian.com.
Incredible time of worship, and welcome everyone to GV Online. He is risen. And if there is ever a time that you want to be online listening and watching, if there's ever a time that you want to be in church with the body of Christ, it's this weekend, Resurrection Sunday. 2.4 billion people are celebrating Easter 2023 this weekend all around the globe. By far the largest group of people gathering, and it dwarfs any other in the world. Do you know that every day 35,000 people are being born again into new life in Jesus? 35,000 a day. Hooray that you've come to join us online today or wherever you might be. Maybe it's tonight, but for many of so many people I've had the privilege of talking with have been maybe hurt by a church or someone like me, and you were judged or you were given a list of rules and things to do that you knew that you couldn't follow. And so you just said, you know what? I just give up. I'm out of here. And I'm sorry that that happened to you. I do regret that. But I am glad that you came here at the right time to join us online. Jesus, born of a virgin, dying for your sins and mine, and Jesus buried, but on the third day, he rose from the dead. And he was seen by 800 people initially, just a few initially, but then 800, and then over 1,000, and at one time, over 500 at one time, and then seen by thousands, as we're going to see here in just a moment. And then he was seen by James. Now, Mary and Joseph went on to have biological children of their own, and James, the half-younger brother of Jesus, never believed that Jesus was God. Are you kidding? Why would you believe that your brother, your older brother, was God? You know, let him teach all he wants to. Let him walk on water all he wants. I don't care, but he's not God. But when Jesus died and rose from the dead, Jesus was no longer an older brother. That's it. James' image. His belief system about Jesus radically changed, just like that. God. He went from being a brother, an older brother, to a savior, to a king, God. Every single one of us who are celebrating Easter, whether you come only once in a great while here at GV Christian, whether you listen once in a great while, or every time the doors are open, you come, or maybe this is your first time being experiencing any kind of church online, every single person will have a different image of Easter Jesus. Maybe created when you were growing up somehow or some way. Maybe by a TV show or a movie that you've seen. Maybe some of you have seen The Chosen. And it was interesting just even to hear an interview by Jonathan Rumi, the guy who plays Jesus in The Chosen. He said, man, it's a heavy responsibility. But some people get even an image implanted in their mind because of an actor, maybe the Passion of the Christ, who knows? But so let me ask you this question. What do you see in your mind's eye when you think about what Jesus is like? Not just physically, but any other way. And who is Jesus in your image of him? And it's not necessarily that our images are wrong. It's that whatever image we have, they're only partial. Even for me, after being a Jesus follower and having that honor of stepping into a relationship with him because he died for me, he rose from the dead. But after 50 years, even my image can still be partial after 50 years. It's kind of like the old story goes, maybe some of you have heard it, it's the elephant story, and the elephant's put in a big warehouse, a dark warehouse, there's no light. And three people are told to go in and grab whatever the first thing that you can grab. And then I want you to give an explanation of what you feel, what you think. And so one guy walks in and he grabs a leg. And the other guy walks in and he grabs a trunk. And another guy walks in and grabs the body. And they come out and say, okay, describe, that was an elephant, describe an elephant. So one guy says, well, it's like a tree. And another person says, it was like a big snake. And the other guy says, it's like a big blimp. All of those are true, but in a sense, none of them are true. And when it comes to our image of Jesus, this is what the word says. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. But then we will see in eternity, but then we will see everything. See what? Everything with perfect clarity. Not only who God really is, but everything else, yourself, the world around you, everything, everything. Resurrection Day is so much more than a story about an empty tomb. Even for those who were alive and were his closest friends, they had different images of Jesus. For Simon, he's called the Zealot. He was intent on seeing Jesus ultimately as a person who could overthrow the Romans. Judas maybe had a tweak. Oh, this guy's good for profit and for bringing in resources. Even those who were closest to him had different images of Jesus, which is why there is a prayer recorded in the Bible for you and for me. And I love this prayer. Written by the Apostle Paul to you and to me as God spoke through him, he said this, this is my prayer. I pray also that your eyes may be enlightened, or that your eyes are enlightened to the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe him. And belief means not just a mental belief that he existed, but it's putting our full weight of trust in him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Now, he is far above any ruler or authority or power or leader or anything else, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. Oh, I love that. That's the Easter story right there. So even those who walked with Jesus in his day had only a partial image of Jesus. And Jesus had said more than once, he said, look, I'm gonna die and I will rise from the dead on the third day. And Jesus was very clear about that. But no one believed that Jesus would rise from the dead. No one. And when Jesus died on that cross, every disciple of Jesus unfollowed Jesus. Why? He's gone. He's dead. No one believed it. And before the sun rose on Sunday, that third day, no one was there at the tomb before the sun came up and looking at just the horizon as it began to come up, and they weren't counting down. Okay, here comes 10, 9, 8. They weren't doing that at all. He's dead. And everyone expected and knew that when Jesus died, Jesus would do what all people do. Stay dead. Everyone was surprised at an empty tomb. Everyone. And when some came to the tomb early that Sunday morning to pay respects according to their culture then, nobody expected to find no body. So, as an example of the surprise, the Bible says this in John chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the entrance. So what does she do? She runs to Peter, and then she runs to Peter, the other disciples, and then Pete and John run to the tomb. Yep, his body's gone. But they still didn't get it. How could they? They still, it says, they just don't understand the scriptures. Well, then it says in verse 10 of chapter 20, John 20, it says the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping, and she wept, and she bent down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and the other at the feet. Woman, why are you weeping? Now, scholars have debated whether or not angels have gender, but this really answers the question, and here's why, because only a man would ask, woman, why are you weeping? Well, Jesus then appears to her, and she just can't believe it. And she's thinking, he's the gardener, but it's Jesus. He's alive. Mary goes back to the disciples, and she says this, I've seen the Lord. And one can only imagine what they must have thought, even if they didn't say it. Yeah, right, this poor woman is grieving and is so deep in her grief that she's just seeing things. She's hallucinating. She's seeing ghosts in her mind's eye. That night, as the disciples are behind locked doors, it says in the word. What kind of doors? Locked. And they're wondering why they're locked. They're locked because they're wondering when they're going to be next to be arrested and killed. And then Jesus suddenly appears. He's just there. No longer limited by time or by space, he's there. And for the next 40 days, he appears to thousands of people. And it would take that long for it to sink in just a little bit what scriptures had said would happen, that Jesus had told them over and over again, and even the scriptures had foretold about it centuries before. Isaiah, the suffering servant, in Isaiah 52, Jesus told them that once, over and over again, that this would happen. But dead people don't resurrect. But he did. So over the next 40 days, their image of Jesus would completely change. Completely. Their whole world would radically change. And in the next few moments here, I want to share with you how my image changed of Jesus in my journey. And you're going to see what are some of the most common beliefs some of the most common images that people have about Jesus. And then what I found out about who Jesus really is. Who is Jesus to you? So as we go through this progression, let me ask you this question. Where do you see yourself on this progressive scale, if you will, on this progression? Each of them are true, but are each fully true? So let's take a look. Here's my story. So I didn't have the privilege and the opportunity of being raised in a church home like many of you may have had. And so I had certain images because most people just have some kind of an image in their mind's eye, once again, from all kinds of sources. But this is probably the most common image. And this was my first image formed of who Jesus is. Because once again, I wasn't raised in church. And I really felt sorry for people who went to church, especially on a spring day in April and maybe late March. But it was a beautiful spring day where I grew up in. And, you know, I'm going to the beach. I don't want to be going inside on a perfectly beautiful sunny day. So this was my first image, the baby Jesus in a manger at Christmas. And it's amazing in our culture that we make a much bigger deal about Christmas than we ever do about Easter. Because of all the warm and fuzzy things that we find. Some of you might be familiar with a comedy movie called Talladega Nights, and there was a prayer that was prayed around the table, and the guy begins to pray, "Dear Lord, baby Jesus." And eventually, you know, his wife begins to attack him. "Look, Jesus grew up and he became a man." And he says, "I like the Christmas Jesus better than I like the baby Jesus better." We like a baby Jesus better than we do a grown-up Jesus. Why? Because we love babies. We love their innocence. They're no threat to me. A baby isn't a threat to me or my lifestyle. I can be in control of a baby. The baby has no authority in my life at all. And so once again, we make a much bigger deal about Christmas than we do Easter. I love Christmas and I love to celebrate. I love everything that goes along with it. But it's amazing how in the Bible, only Luke, out of 4 gospel narratives, talk about a baby. Only Dr. Luke. Mark and John, in their gospels, there's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mark and John don't say a word about Christmas or the birth of Jesus. Well, next, that's the first step. In my journey, then as I began to get a little bit older, I thought, well, I think Jesus, if it ever came up, I really thought of it. But when it did, I knew that going through school and these different things, that Jesus then was a historical person, a prophet, and a miracle worker. I guess he performed miracles. Yeah, I believe he existed because there are historical books and there is proof, and you'd see it here and there, that he existed. And others outside of the Bible wrote about the miracles that he did. Yeah, I believe that he existed, but so did Buddha, so did Muhammad, and so did many other religious figures of the past. Well, next, and so where do you fit? Maybe you fit in one of those first two. How about this next progression? He was a good man. Yeah, I think, you know what? He was a good man. Look at the good things he did. I just had somebody tell me that just this week. Yeah, Jesus, he was a good man. But it's only a partial image of who Jesus really is. Was he a man? Absolutely. But it's just a small little speck of who he really is. Next, he was a great teacher, and he said some really good things, you know, the golden rule and all that stuff, which the Bible never says that, but, you know, yeah, he's a great teacher of things that we should do. He was the greatest teacher that ever lived, it sounds like to me. But if Jesus was just a teacher, then really what happens is that he becomes just this nice professor, with some good wisdom and good life lessons and good principles that are really good and we should apply them. You know, maybe kind of like Yoda, or how about Mr. Rogers with a beard? Yeah, he's really a good teacher. But maybe for some like me, as time went on, Jesus became this. He was a savior on a cross. Yeah, he saved the world, he died. And so maybe you grew up with the image because for so many people, Jesus is still on the cross. So maybe you saw a statue, you grew up with a statue, and there's Jesus on the cross. And maybe for some, what happens is that some form of religion keeps Jesus as a savior for the world on the cross. And for some, the progression stops there. But between this step and the next step, there is a huge gulf. Between this one and the next, something happened in my life. And something incredible happens when we step into a relationship with an alive Jesus, a Jesus who rose from the dead on that first Easter. And all of a sudden, it becomes very real, and it became very personal, so real. And it moves from being Jesus was to Jesus is. And so there's a shift in the image that I had of Jesus. Jesus is, not was, but is, my Savior who died for me. And so, at the age of 17, while reading the Bible, reading the book of Matthew, and it was during the Jesus movement or the Jesus revolution. Some of you have seen that movie, that movement that's become really popular now because of the movie, the Jesus Revolution. And I knew that Jesus died for me and that it was personal. It wasn't just Jesus out there somewhere on a cross. It wasn't just a man, just wasn't a good teacher, but he died for me personally. And there was a sense of, even at 17, that I put him on that cross. That was just the love of God. It was the Holy Spirit moving on the inside of me. And Jesus became my best friend, my closest ally, who gave all of a sudden purpose and meaning and wisdom and direction when I was searching before. And all of a sudden, his word, it became the bread of life. I couldn't get enough of the word because it was Jesus speaking to me. Jesus is my Savior who died for me. It was personal. And maybe for some of you, you've yet to really discover that Jesus is a Savior who died for you. Well, the progression continues. And it goes along really with what I've said, that Jesus is alive. More real than anything that I had ever known. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And in Jesus, because he conquered death and the grave, we pass from death to life. Death no longer has the last word. And at that age of 17, I had experienced very few people close to me that had died. But as life went on, as it changed, he's so real. And then the last image of Jesus. And it doesn't mean when you reach this point that you've arrived or that you're better than anybody else. It just means that you're growing and maturing and progressing in your image of who Jesus is. And so, Jesus is my Lord and my King. He's my Lord and my King. Look at these few verses. When he had cleansed us from our sins, meaning Jesus on the cross and rose from the dead, he sat down in the place of honor at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. Oh, majestic. He's a king. He's not just man, he's God. I love what Pete said to the church at large as God spoke to him. Jesus has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. Everything is in submission to him. Why? Because the Bible says he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And the most important mission in life is to be obedient, motivated out of my love for Jesus because he loved me first. And I know that if Jesus is Lord of all and King, I bow the knee before the Lord of all. There's a holy reverence, not a fright, but a fear of the Lord. I bow that he's my King. And let me say it again. When I reach that point, it doesn't mean that somehow I had arrived. It means that I follow. I keep growing into having my eyes enlightened into who Jesus really is and becoming more and more like him. Because here's the amazing thing. As my image of Jesus changes, I become more like Jesus, more Christ-like. At least that's my hope and my prayer. Some of you may not believe it, but that's my prayer. I love this verse. It says this, "And the Lord, who is the Spirit," so we have God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit, "makes us more like him as we are changed into his glorious image." So literally, when our image of him grows and when it changes and matures, our own image, our self-esteem changes, our self-worth changes. We are his son and his daughter. And Jesus, and the focus of being obedient to him, because he's a Lord, he's the one and only Lord, he is my King. And my goal is to be obedient and a servant and a slave of his. Bible wrote about this. Paul did. He said, "I am a servant of Jesus." He said it over and over again. He said, "I am a slave to the Lord, whatever he wants." Why would you ever want to change your image of Jesus from whatever it is now to who Jesus really is? Why? Because Jesus, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and because of what he has done, life becomes so much better than you can ever imagine. And you become better at life than you can ever imagine. And it doesn't mean that problems or issues go away. In fact, they might even increase. But he's my servant. He's my Lord. And when Jesus is Lord of all, not only your reality, your image of Jesus changes and of yourself, but the reality of everything changes for the better. How you see your spouse, how you see your neighbor, how you see that sinner that cuts you off in traffic. I've gotten irritated. Woof. And rather than somebody cutting you off and pronouncing eternal damnation on their soul, you say they're a child of God. God, save them if they don't know you. Save them from their own driving. It changes everything. Everything gets better. And my goal as a spiritual coach and mentor, because it is the goal of Jesus, is to help all of you move along in a progression of not who you think Jesus is, but growing in who he really is. And it's not what your neighbor thinks. It's not what a coworker thinks. It's not what maybe even your parents think or somebody that's close to you, but who does Jesus say that he is? And Jesus said, "I'm God. And I'm going to prove it to you when I rise from the dead, just like I've told you that I will do." And either Jesus was a liar, the greatest con man who ever lived, and 2.4 billion people are suckers, or Jesus was completely insane, or The third option is it. He is Lord of all. He is the King of Kings. And either Jesus is Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. What if I were to tell you, if you become a Jesus follower and if you accept him as your Lord and Savior, there will be no more school shootings. Would that convince you to follow Jesus? If we were sitting down over coffee and you might say, you know what, I think you're a nut. Either that or a liar or some kind of a religious deluded dude. What if I were to tell you that one day there will be no more funerals? There'll be no more death, no more dying, no more hospitals, no more sickness, no more pain, no more tears, only God's pure love and God's pure light. Would that convince you to become a Jesus follower and to really see him as a personal friend and Lord and King of Kings? I love this verse because it's a picture into the future for those who are Jesus followers. Jesus will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All of these things are gone forever. What made it possible? Easter. Jesus rose from the dead. He's alive. And he's seated at the right hand of the God of heaven, as we've just read. He is my King and yours. He is my Lord and yours. And with a King and with a Lord, the difference is that we all bow the knee. And Jesus said, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. Whether we do it now on this side of eternity or on the other side, we will all do it because his glory and his light will push out any darkness. Would you pray with me? I want to pray a simple prayer, and it's a prayer maybe you found yourself along that scale, that progression, maybe somewhere. Maybe you're listening and you're a complete agnostic. You never believed even, I mean, maybe Jesus was a baby. Yeah, you know, because he grew up to be a man, a historical figure, but there's nothing there. But you're listening because the love of God is wooing you into a relationship with him. And we can fight it and resist it, but God's love woos us and draws us into the purity of his light and of his love. I want to pray a simple prayer. And would you repeat this prayer right after me, just in your thinking, maybe out loud? It's this prayer. Jesus, I thank you that you died for me. And I thank you that you died, and I confess that it was my mistakes, my regrets, my failures that put you on that cross. And you died for me. And I ask you to forgive me. And I confess that you rose from the dead. And I confess that you are my Lord and my Savior. Thank you that you died for me. And I now choose to follow you, Jesus. And I'm going to join today approximately 35,000 other people who will say Jesus is Lord. In your name I pray. Amen. Do you know the Bible says the angels are rejoicing in heaven just for you? There's a QR code at the bottom of your screen. We want to help you get started. Maybe you have a question about this message. Maybe you have a question. Look, you have a lot of questions. And it's amazing what people can do when they have questions. Say, well, I don't want to come to, I still have a lot of questions. Well, you've made a lot of big decisions where all the questions weren't answered. If you're married, did you have all your questions answered? How about if you had kids? Did you have all your questions answered? We're here to help. We don't claim to have all the answers, but we're here to help you. Find the greatest abundant life and eternal life that you can have in knowing Jesus. God bless you. I love you. And next weekend, we're going to begin a new series on the Spirit of the living God, the third person of the Godhead. We'll see you there. Let me pray for you. Father, would you bless your people and keep them and cause your face to shine upon them? And that can happen because you're alive. You are alive. And you give your peace, not as the world gives, because this is a broken, hurting world, but it's a peace that only you can give. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. God bless you. I love you. We'll see you online next weekend.